أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه وله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد, we continue إن شاء الله with our lectures in explanation of the book of the impact of the 14 قراءات of the Quran on the lessons or the teachings or the instructions of العقيدة and al-fiqh, the creed and the jurisprudence. Inshallah, this lecture will be the one before the last, inshallah. So for the next lecture, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen, if Allah give us life, would be the last lecture in this beautiful series, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. Today's lecture might be short. I don't guarantee that. So it depends, inshallah, on how we go, because there's some fiqhi issues. Last time we talked about the relationship between qira'at and fiqh from one side, the understanding of the sharia and the rulings, and between the qurra' themselves, like the reciters, and the fuqaha', the jurists, how each of the jurists, like Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad, they were impacted by the qira'at, they adopted the qira'at that they recited on their contemporary scholars of Qira'at at that time. Like Imam Shafi'i is impacted by the Qira'at of Ibn Kathir, as we will see even today in the issues of Al-Ista'adha and Basmala and Takbir between surahs and all of that, in the Salah and outside of the Salah, you know, major issues. So first is in the section of At-Tahara. Shaykh Walid Hafizahullah mentioned here the first section of Fiqh At-Tahara, and what are the ayat that affects that. First is the rule of the woman after finishing her menstrual period, after the time of al-hayd, after the time of al-hayd. When the woman finishes her period and the bleeding stops, and then she takes the ghusl after that, so she becomes tahir or pure, and then the husband can have intercourse with each other. So this is the mas'ala, or this is the issue here. Can the husband have intercourse with her before she takes the bath or the shower? No, the full body shower, or is it wudu only, or is it cleaning the private part only from the bleeding and its any trace of it, and then they can have the intercourse? So this is where the madhahib differ based on the qira'at of the Quran. Allah Azza wa Jal said, do not have intercourse with your wives while they are in their period, in the menstrual period, until they have the tahara. So the word, we'll talk about it now, after tahara. And because the qira'at is different, then they differed. Does tahara, does it mean the bath, or the full body shower, or does it mean the wudu only, or does it mean the cleaning of that part, of the private part, from any trace of bleeding? All opinions are there, by the way, and all opinions are among the scholars. Some of them said one, not the other two. Some of them said it is a matter of a choice, and we will see that. So, but the mas'ala is, if the woman finishes her menstrual period and then she and her husband want to have the intercourse, does she have to have the full ghusl or not? So that's the mas'ala. So let's see the qira'at in this ayah, Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 2:22. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْمَحِيضِ. They ask you about the menstrual period for women. قُلْ هُوَ أَذَى. Say it is harm. فَاعْتَزِلُوا النِّسَاءَ فِي الْمَحِيضِ. يعني avoid the intercourse, specific intercourse with women during their menstrual period. Of course, we have the hadith that says the man and the woman can touch each other, can hug each other, can have everything except the penetration or the intercourse. فَاعْتَزِلُوا النِّسَاءَ فِي الْمَحِيطِ. So avoid them in that, with that understanding. The avoidance here is understood from the sunnah. وَلَا تَقْرَبُوهُنَّ. And don't come close to them. Again, you know, what does it mean? وَلَا تَقْرَبُوهُنَّ doesn't mean that you keep distance physically from the wife. Don't touch it, No, this is not what it meant here. ولا تقربوهن حتى يطهرن means no penetration, no intercourse. That area is forbidden. فإذا تطهرن فأتوهن من حيث أمركم الله. When they are in state of tahara, when they are pure, then have intercourse with them the way Allah Azza wa Jalla allowed you or the way Allah ordered you. إن الله يحب التوابين ويحب المتطهرين. Allah truly surely love those who repent, the repenting servants and the purifying servants. So the word here of the qira'at, ولا تقربوهن, don't touch or don't come close to them, don't have intercourse, حتى يطهرن. The qira'a يطهرن and there is a qira'a يطهرن. يطهرن with the shadda. And both have slight difference here. So Ibn Kathir, Imam Nafi', Imam Abu Amr, Imam Ibn Amir, الإمام حفص عن عاصم, not all عاصم but حفص only, يعقوب and أبو جعفر and this from the 10, والحسن واليزيدي from the other 4, they said يطهرن like we you know normally recite and hear. يطهرن. Now شعبة عن عاصم, so حفص عن عاصم like that, but شعبة is the other قراء. شعبة عن عاصم, حمزة الكسائي and the خلف from the 10, and Ibn Muhaysin wal-A'mash from the 4, they said يطهرن with a shadda on the ta and another shadda on the ha, double shadda. The other one without shadda on either, يطهرن. يطهرن. This one يطهرن. Now, majority of the fuqaha, they said that the woman, when her bleeding stops for the menstrual period, so no bleeding at all, her husband cannot have intercourse with her unless she uses water. She uses water. And this is the opinion of Imam Malik, Imam Al-Awza'i, Imam Al-Shafi'i, Imam Al-Thawri, Imam Ahmad Ibn Hanbal, and it is famous in the opinion of Abu Hanifa. So basically four of them. But in the Hanafi, it is famous on that. I'm sorry, without except Abu Hanifa. So Malik, Shafi'i, Ahmad, Al-Awza'i, Al-Thawri, all of those, they say that the woman have to use water once the bleeding stops. We'll say what use water means in a minute. The famous opinion, according to Abu Hanifa, that if her bleeding stops less than 10 days, so she has the ruling of Hayd until she has to take a bath if she finds the water or the time of Salah, lapsed, finished. Then she has, from the time she stops bleeding, there is a time for one Salah, then she has to take the ghusl. So if one of those, she's out of the hayd, and then she have to she can have the intercourse with the husband. But if she finished the hayd, finished 10 days, so that's according to Abu Hanifa less than 10 days. We'll say why in a minute. But if it is 10 days, then the hayd finish, the bleeding stops, then the husband and her can have the intercourse. And if the عدة, if she's in عدة, divorce, the عدة will be over after the last 10. Why 10 days? Because according to the Ahnaf, the maximum time for حيض is 10 days. So if the bleeding continues after that, it's not considered حيض. Okay. So the maximum time for حيض, according to Ahnaf, is 10 days. Maximum number of حيض is 10 days. So they said if her hayd take all 10 days and it stops, then she is okay, and then the husband, her and her husband can have the intercourse. But if she's less than that, then she have to take the ghusl. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari in his tafsir, and he's a faqih as well. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari is a jurist as well. He said there is difference what tatahur means, what is purification. Here is the mas'ala, here is the issue of the qira'at now. What did Allah Azza wa Jalla mean by yathurna or yattahurna? it is the issue of when which one would decide that she's pure or not, which one, what does it mean and what the purity means. So he said, Ibn Jarir said, some of the scholars said it has to be the full bath, al-ightisal bil-ma, and her husband cannot have intercourse with her until she encompasses, the water encompasses the whole body. Ghusl, يعني, ghusl from al-hayd. Some of them said it is just wudu for salah. Ibn Jarir al-Tabri is mentioning that. Said it is wudu for salah. Others said, but it is only washing of the private part. If she washes that and she makes sure no trace from any bleeding or anything, then the intercourse can happen. So Ata and the Qatada are the ones who said that washing only the private part would be enough. طبعاً, this would not be enough for her to make salah. We are talking only about the issue of husband-wife intercourse, because the ayah is talking about that. Don't do it if she's in haid, but do it after the haid, right? And this is where the mas'ala is. So it's talking about intercourse. When can it happen? Before ghusl or after ghusl? Is it ghusl only, wudu, or washing of the place, right? But it does not allow the woman to pray, for example, unless she, of course, take the bath. Imam Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri, he said it is optional. Any one of the three is optional. Why? He said because all of that in the Sharia, it's called tatahur or tuhr. If you say tatahur, yattahharn. يعني يتطهرن يتطهرن وده شدة تطهر. said if you say to the woman تطهري تطهري or طهر means اطهري or تطهري, it means the same, means wash the place, the area, or make wudu or make غسل. So all the word will refer to all three. So according to Ibn Hazm, said she has the option of any of the three, right? Why? He said because Allah عز وجل said in Surah At-Tawbah verse 108, referring to Al-Ansar and the Masjid of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, said فيه رجال يحبون أن يتطهروا. So طهارة here, it is a description of men who are in the Masjid of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, or in Medina, Masjid, يعني in Masjid Quba or Masjid of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. In Medina in general, Allah عز وجل talking to about them that they like to have تطهر, and nobody said that they take غسل for the salah. Tatahuri means they were making istinja, means they are washing after they respond to the call of nature with water. And Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah, Sheikh Urid mentioned here, Sheikh Al-Albani, rahmatullah alayhi, who died in 1420 of Hijra, he said, there is no dalil in the Quran or Sunnah that confines the meaning of tatahharna, that it is ghusl. فَإِذَا تَطَهَّرْنَا it is ghusl only. So all of those three are there. And he said there is nothing in the sunnah saying that she has to take ghusl to have intercourse with her husband, except one hadith, and it is hadith daif. One hadith, and it's a hadith daif. So if anybody uses that hadith, you know that this is hadith daif. And the hadith is the hadith of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, mentioned in آداب الزفاف, حديث عبد الله بن عباس, that he said that رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said إذا أتى أحدكم امرأته في الدم فليتصدق بدينار. If a person have intercourse with his wife while she is in her period, طبعا it is haram, it is prohibited, but what would be a kafara for that is to repent to Allah and give صدقة one dinar. وإذا وطئها وقد رأت الطهرة, and if he have intercourse with her after her bleeding stops, and this is where the hadith is quoted for, ولم تغتسل, and she did not have the غسل, فلتصدق بنصف دينار, he gives half dinar. So this is the hadith which is ضعيف, يعني it is not used for that. So anyways, the word يطهرنا or the word يطهرنا, فإذا تطهرنا, so all of that can mean all of this, and the difference, there are differences among the scholars. So and it is better to get out of that, the woman take the ghusl after her haid before intercourse. But if she does make wudu or she washes the private part, still can, you know, husband or wife can have the intercourse, but that's not enough, of course, for, you know, to allow her to make salah. The next issue in the tahara, section of tahara, is washing of the feet. We have this ayah in Surah Al-Ma'idah, فَغْسِلُوا يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَيُهُ بِلِيبِ إِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ if you go to the salah, فَغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ to get ready يعني for salat, wash your faces, وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ and your arms to including the elbows, وَامْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ wiping on your head, وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ إِلَى الْكَعْبَيْنِ and your feet to الْكَعْبَيْنِ to the ankles. And this is the qiraat here, وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ this is one, وَأَرْجُلِكُمْ two, وَأَرْجُلُوكُمْ three qiraat. The third, أَرْجُلُوكُمْ is qiraat al-hasan. And we will say what is important. وَأَرْجُلِكُمْ means masح. وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ means غسل. Now masح here has the debate, يعني, the issues. The issue of explanation here. يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا قمتم إلى الصلاة فاغسلوا وجوهكم وده فتحة وأيديكم وده فتحة إلى المرافق وامسحوا برؤوسكم مسح here. So there are two verbs mentioned in this ayah. One is the غسل, one is the مسح. And you have four different parts to be handled. So you have four objects and you have two different verbs. The problem is that it is not like one verb and two, and then one verb and two. It did not happen like that. It happened like ghasl first, the washing, the verb, and then two things following it. اغسلوا وجوهكم وأيديكم. And we know from the sunnah there's ghasl in both, right? اغسلوا وجوهكم وأيديكم. Then came the masح. Then came one word that can be in masح and can be in ghasl. Alright? So Allah Azza wa Jalla did not say غسلوا وجوهكم وأيديكم إلى المرافق وأرجلكم. So that would follow ghasl. Then وامسحوا برؤوسكم مسح. Then everybody understands. But then the order is not observed. Because, you know, wiping the head comes before washing the feet. Right? And that is where the qira'at finish. And this is the hikmah and the beauty of the Quran. How Allah Azza wa Jalla want to give you the two things. Now, that is one issue. So, ghasl, washing, ghasl, washing, masah, wiping, then the word here can be with ghasl or masah. So that is one. Number two, what is the masah that meant here? If you say, وَأَرْجُلِكُمْ or وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ, because the word إِلَى الْكَعْبَيْنِ, there is no masah to the ka'bayn. That if you think it is masah, you know, wiping, there is no masah to the ka'bayn. So what is that issue? And the Sheikh was here mentioning, mashallah, a beautiful explanation. So the Rafida, the people, not the Sunnah, يعني, they saying that masah is enough. So without, we're not talking about socks now. They are talking masah without socks. So a person, after washing all of that, they will say that the word وَأَرْجُلِكُمْ and it is a qira'ah, which is right, it is a qira'ah. It is a qira'ah in the Quran. But they will wipe on their bare skin without washing. Without washing. So they will, as they wipe on the head, they will also wipe on their feet. So the other qira'ah, of course, doesn't prove that. Actually, it negates it. It negates that because أبو جعفر الإمام الإمام نافع الإمام نافع الإمام عاصم according to حفص عند الكسائي ويعقوب they recite وأرجلكم that means washing الحسن وأرجلكم means washing or wiping because وأرجلكم here can be in both if you do with ضمة it can go both غسل or مسح أبو جعفر أبو عمرو بن كثير and شعبة عن عاصم حمزة عن خلف from the 10 ابن محنسن والأعمش واليزيدي from the 4 they said وأرجلكم means مسح So a group masḥ, a group ghasl, and Al Hasan Al Basri, only his qira'ah gives you the option. It can be both. So the majmu' of the qira'at, or those totality of the three qira'at, gives the option of Al Ghasl, I mean the permissibility of Al Ghasl and Al Masḥ. Alright. So when we say وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ, it's easy. You wash your face, you wash your arms, you wipe your head, and you wash your feet until Al-Ka'bayn. Great? Until Al-Ka'bayn. So this is Qira'ah we all know and we understand it. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, hadith of Abu Huraira, when some of the Sahaba were making wudu and he saw the heels, their heels have some shine on it, that means it was not touched by water, is it dry skin? So he said, وَيْلُ لِلْأَعْقَابِ مِنَ النَّارِ, woe, or beware of the punishment of these heels from hellfire if they are not washed with wudu. So that also shows the ghasl, dalil of ghasl until the ankles. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said in a hadith, ثُمَّ يَغْسِلُ قَدَمَيْهِ, and he washes his feet كَمَا أَمَرَهُ اللَّهُ, as Allah Azza wa Jalla ordered him. And no one of the Sahaba was not narrated from any of the Sahaba that they did not wash their feet, except Ali ibn Abi Talib, Abdullah ibn Abbas and the Anas in the beginning, and then after that it was narrated from them that they washed their feet like everybody else. Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Layla, one of the great Tabi'een, he said, أجمع أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, it is a consensus among the Sahaba of Rasulullah, على غسل القدمين, to wash their feet. Ibn Rushd in his book, Ibn Rushd Abu al-Walid al-Qurtubi, faqih of Maliki school, he said, the ulama agreed, اتفق العلماء على أن الرجلين من أعضاء الوضوء, that the feet until the ankle from the parts of the wudu to be washed. But they differed in how they are purified. Some of them, the majority, يعني الجمهور, they said with washing them. And the others said the obligation is to wipe or masḥ, the word masḥ, and we'll see what is the meaning of masḥ that they refer to. And the others said, no, it can be either or, with ghasl or with masḥ, is optional. And the difference, Imam Ibn Rushd still talking, he said, and the reason of the difference, because of those two qira'ah, arjula wa arjuli, arjulakum wa arjulikum. Arjulakum means maghsul, ghasl, arjulikum means mamsuh, means masah. So, each jurist chose, those who chose ghasl, they said the other one means ghasl, and they tried also to interpret it to support that. Those who said it has to be masḥ, they said both means masḥ, and they give the grammatical reasoning for that. And those who said it is either or, they said the first one is for ghasl and the second one for masḥ. So it depends, what is the opinion of fiqh, and they try to see how the Arabic word is used to support that. Some says that the masḥ is the must, and Ibn Jarir al-Tabari say that, and tawan that is wrong. Sheikh Walid say that this is not right, because actually Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, the nice part here, that according to him it is a must to wash the feet. So if somebody says, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said the must is to make masḥ, not to make ghasl, is wrong. And the Sheikh will say why. For two reasons. Number one, that according to Imam al-Tabari, the obligation for the feet is washing, and according to him, masḥ means rubbing it, means doing the both action. Both action is ghasl and masḥ. Ghasl, he said that masḥ means ghasl also with rubbing the feet. So like this. So masḥ is like that, wiping. But he said, according to Ibn Jarir and the other scholars who followed, they said, arjulakum or arjulikum means ghasl and masḥ. So ghasl means wash only, pouring water and covering it with water. But masḥ means you are rubbing it. So you need two. You need both, but they mean غسل with rubbing. So دلك يعني. This is the meaning of what Ibn Jarir al-Tabri said. طيب. How they said Ibn Jarir said that? Where did they bring this from? Imam Ibn Hajar, Shaykh Walid mentioned here, that he answers that. He said that this is not Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. It is not Muhammad Ibn Jarir al-Tabari al-Mufassir. There is another person, his name also is Muhammad Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. He is Rafida. That is the one. His name is Muhammad Ibn Jarir Ibn Rustum al-Tabari. The other one is not that. It's not Muhammad Ibn Jarir Ibn Zayd. You see the importance of the biography of the Muhaddithin and their names. So you have Muhammad Ibn Jarir Ibn Zayd al-Tabari. Muhammad Ibn Jarir Ibn Rustum al-Tabari. يعني the grandfather's name being English. So some people said Muhammad Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said, and they are right, but they are mudallis. They are making tadlis, and this tadlis means making it ambiguous for you. So when I say that brother Muhammad from Houston, brother Muhammad Ali Ahmed from Houston came and studied with me, and then you find Muhammad Ali Ahmed, said you were the one who studied with Sheikh Mamdouh. He said yes, but then I tell you that's not Muhammad Ali Ahmed from Houston, the one who studied with me. The one who studied with me, Muhammad Ali Ahmed Mahmoud. You see now, I added one. The other one is not Mahmoud. So here is the same thing. They said Muhammad Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said that masḥ means wiping is the obligation. Yes, there is Muhammad Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said that, but not the one who Ahl al-Sunnah. This one is from Rafid. Yeah. So, now, what masḥ means here? We're not talking about socks yet. Right? So masḥ here, we're talking about feet, barefoot, according to those two qira'ah, one saying ghasl, one says masḥ, and we understand now what ghasl and masḥ means. Masḥ, because if you say wiping, the wiping is not to the ankles, there is no wiping to the ankle, but wiping is on the shoes or on the khuf or on the socks, and only the front of it. يعني there is nobody said that you make the masḥ until al-ka'bayn, like the ghasl. So it is not talking about that. But the Shaykh here said, we answer the qira'ah of al-jar, wa arju likum. And the Shaykh said, this is pure, one answer would be purely grammatical reason. It means, both it means washing of the feet. How sometimes the for some grammatical construct, grammatical formation of the sentence, you put a kasra even though it can be fatha or dhamma. And he give examples. Like in the Quran, Surah Al-Ahqaf 21, Prophet Sayyidina Hud, يعني, telling his people, إِنِّي أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ عَذَابَ يَوْمٍ عَظِيمٍ. إني أخاف, I'm afraid. What is going to happen to you, my people? أخاف عليكم, I'm afraid for you. عذاب, فتحة, عذاب, punishment. يوم, a day. عظيم, great. Right? Now, عظيم is a description of عذاب. It's not the description of the day. So, عذاب, عظيم in that day. In a day, right? But here, the description is separated from, the adjective is separated from the noun with another noun. It's عذاب عظيم. عذاب عظيمة. عظيما. عذابي عظيم. عذاب عظيم. Like that. So it follows. But here عذاب فتحة. يوم with كسرة. Then عظيم came because it is following a noun with كسرة even though it's not describing that noun. It just follows it even though it is describing the noun before. So when you are making إعراب in the Nahu, in the grammar, you will say that it is mansub, but it is busy with the kasra for following its neighbor, right? But it has to have a fatha muqaddara. So this is a purely grammatical issue. So that's one answer here. So we're saying, يَا لَذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ فَاغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ. Ha. وجوهكم فتحة وأيديكم إلى المرافق وامسحوا برؤوسكم. They say because رؤوسكم here is كسرة and أرجلكم does not follow the مسح, right? But when it comes to أرجليكم to have مناسبة, to have some relevance to the word before it, even though it is not related to it, is related to the word before. So purely grammatical issue, and they come out from that and say this ayah does not indicate anything in the masḥ. You take the dalil of masḥ from sunnah. So this ayah in the Quran both means washing, whether arjulakum or arjulikum. I hope that one is understood. Yeah. So they said this fatḥa and kasra is purely for grammatical relevance. What comes after what? If it's kasra here, it's kasra has to be kasra after to become easy to recite and so on, right? So this is that. So they said according to the Quran, arjulakum, no big deal. Wa arjulikum, it is like fatha, but it came here kasra because of the necessity of the grammatical order here. Yeah, and also the Sheikh give examples according to the grammarians like Sibawayh wal Akhfash are the ones who responded to that. And they said, for example, the qira'a of Hamza al-Kisai wa Abu Ja'far wal Hasan in Hurun Een, they said Hurin Een, Hurin Een. Even though before it there is Wildanun Mukhalladun, it's Hurin Een. They said it's supposed to be Hurun Een, but they recited with the kasra for the same grammatical thing as I mentioned, even though it is following the Hurun Een, Wildanun Mukhalladun. Wildanun Mukhalladun in the beginning and then Hurun Een after. So some other qira'a said Wildanun Mukhalladun and then said Hurin with the kasra. There's grammatical necessity, but it should have the dhamma. Yeah, so and give few examples that this happened. Like Juhru Dabbin Kharibin. Juhru Dabbin Kharibin. Dabb is the lizard that they eat in Arabia. So they used to say Juhru. Juhru is the nest or the hole that the lizard goes. And Kharib means deserted. Means there is a hole that it is deserted. No Dabb lives in it. So Juhru, Juhr here is the noun that will be described as deserted or not. And the Dabb is the inhabitant of that. So here said Juhru Dabbin Kharibin. Even though Kharibin is not the description of Dabbin, it is the description of Juhru, supposed to have Dhamma. But it has Kasra because the noun before it has Kasra. So that's how the Arabs spoke. يعني. So the Sheikh here said that the grammarians answered that from the grammar perspective. Alright. Second respond, Abu Ali al-Farisi, one of the great grammarians as well, Sheikh Khalid mentioning here, he said, even though it is following the ru'us, ru'usikum and arjulikum, with the kasra, he said that many of the scholars, as we mentioned a while ago, that it means ghasl also, because masḥ means washing with rubbing, right? With rubbing the feet. Also, they're saying that there is some nice meaning here. They said masḥ means ghasl khafif, yani it means light washing, right? So somebody can have water in his hand and put on his feet and rub it. That's ghasl. That will use less water. So they are saying that this ayah here, the difference is about the usage of water. Because ghasl, you pour water over while you are washing, so you consume more water. But masḥ, more of the act of your hand is washing around the feet, right? So masḥ, use less water, ghasl, use more water. Because both said إلى الكعبين, right? So that is the second answer. Sheikh Walid mentioned the third answer. He said, we say that even though it is following رؤوس, but it does not following يعني رؤوس means مسح, but it is مسح in a specific occasion that the sunnah showed us while the person is wearing the خف like Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم was doing. So those are the three opinions. One says about it's a grammatical need. So both mean the same, ghasl. And masḥ here, al khuffin or udat khuffin, no dalil for it, okay, in the Quran. That's one. And the second one, that the ghasl also means that it is a type of washing which is different from the first one. And the third one, that it is masḥ if they are covered with khuff. All right. Some of the scholars, though, said that it was masḥ in the beginning, but it became abrogated and the ghusl was there. But يعني we are not gonna use that. Even some of the scholars like Ibn Hazm and al-Tahawi mentioned that. But the correct one, you don't go to the abrogation as a reasoning if you can gather between them as we did. طيب. The next مسألة, which I think we will finish with يعني today, is the مسألة of wudu. For wudu, for touching woman. If a person touches the woman, that break the wudu or not. And it happened, the difference happened between the ulama, predecessors or followers in this mas'ala, contemporary and before. A group says that it voids the wudu altogether. So if a man touches a woman, voids the wudu. This woman is mahram, his wife, other than wife, any woman a man touches, his wudu will break. And the other side is the other extreme. So one that side said if a man touches a woman, the wudu is voided, whoever that woman. The man touches the woman, does not void the wudu regardless of that woman, regardless of his intention. And there are a group in the middle. They say it will break the wudu in certain occasions with certain conditions and would not in others. And this has happened in qira'at in the ayah, Surah An-Nisa, ayah number 43. وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ مَرْضَى أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ أَوْ جَاءَ أَحَدٌ مِّنْكُمْ مِّنَ الْغَائِطِ أَوْ لَامَسْتُمُ النِّسَاءُ or لَمَسْتُمُ النِّسَاءُ لَامَسْتُمْ or لَمَسْتُمْ فَلَمْ تَجِدُوا مَاءً فَتَيَمَّمُوا صَعِيدًا طَيِّبًا. سورة النساء verse 43, also سورة المائدة verse 6, same thing, that the things that violate the wudu. If you are sick or you are traveling or some of you respond to the call of nature or you touch the women and you don't find water, then you make wudu, make tayammum. So that means if you have water, you make wudu. Yeah. So according to Hamza والكسائي وخلف from the 10 and الأعمش from the 4, لمستم without ألف لمس. And the rest they said لامستم from ملامسة, لمسة ولامسة from لمس and ملامسة, so two different. Some said that the two قراءة they are in the same meaning skin touching skin. Simple as that. Whether lamastum or lamastum, the meaning is the same. Means your skin touched the skin of the woman. And the other meaning, they said both the same meaning and they mean intercourse. Okay? Because lams here means intercourse. The others different. Said one means touching only and one means intercourse. And then you have two groups. One says lams is that and the other said mulamasa is that. Lamasa means intercourse and the lamasa means touching. While the other said no, this is the opposite. So the, here is that. Those are the two qira'at and these are the qira'at and these are the differences of the meaning according to many, right? So we have three things here. What are the qira'at? Lamastum and lamastum. Lamastum and lamastum, right? Now, the meaning of the qira'at, some says one means, both means the same and they mean touching. The second group said both means the same and they mean intercourse. And the one in the middle says no, one means intercourse and one means touching and they differed which one is which. All right, so that's issue number two. Issue number three, the madhahib of fiqh, right? Whatever it means, يعني, they said, okay, if a man touches a woman, now what is the hukm? Right? So we have two qira'at, we have three opinions on what they mean, and we have three madhab in fiqh, what it leads to, right? According to that understanding. يعني we have this different. So now Ibn Rushd al-Hafid in fiqh, يعني, the book of comparative fiqh that he has, بداية المجتهد ونهاية المقتصد, he's saying the ulama differed in the obligation of wudu from touching women with the hand or with any other, يعني if a feet come on a feet or the hand come on the hand or the hand touches the face, يعني any skin over skin, right? That is the mulamasa. So he said that If this happens, then a person has to have wudu, obligated, cannot pray without that wudu. So that is group number one. And they said whoever have the kiss also, kissing. Whether it is with the lust or without a lust. And this is according to a Shafi'i. And they differed in between. So now, who make wudu? The person who touched or the person who was touched? So again, the Imam al-Shafi'i said the wudu happens on the person who touched, who did the touch, not the one who's touched. And in other case, he make them both have to have wudu. And also some cases, according to Shafi'i, it is difference between mahram or non-mahram. Mahram or the wife and non-mahram. So he said that it become have wudu the one who touches the wife, but not wudu the one who touches his mother or his daughter or his sister, and some other cases. So there is issues among the scholars in this. According to the Shafi'i, is strict. Yeah. So be careful with that. Some others said if the wudu only breaks, or the wudu becomes an obligation to pray after touching the woman, if it happens with a lust, with some feeling, with some shahwa, يعني, and there is also difference in that. If it happens something in between, or skin over skin, except you know kissing, they said whether it is with lust or without lust, that you know have to have wudu, and this is the madhab of Malik. Okay. Madhab of Abu Hanifa, they said no wudu at all. For touching the woman, and each one of those groups have companions that they follow, and this was also opinions of companions. Whether you any woman you touch, is it a wife or not, or mahram? The difference is it kissing or not kissing? Is it touching skin over skin, or some glove or something in between? Is it kiss? You know, all of that. So they have those issues, and the Sheikh said here in books of fiqh, يعني, more details in this regard. And all of those, there are ahadith and everything, except subhanallah, this condition of having the lust or having this shahwa or that feeling, no one of the sahaba actually make this as a condition over there, but always about the touch. Many of the ulama, they said, okay, what is meant here by lams? So this is the opinions of the fiqh about touching, right? So now, is it lams means in the course, or lams means the touching of the skin? They have those two opinions. And the other opinion says it is the touch of the skin. Then the hadith of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, while he's praying, he might touch Aisha. Right? So if the wudu breaks, his salah would break, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but he never left his salah. And touching him or he's touching her, both happened. Also, there is the other hadith that Aisha radiallahu anha said that Rasulullah sallam kissed one of his wives, and he went to the salah, and her nephew Urwa ibn Zubair, he's the one narrating hadith, he said, I think it is you. So she laughed after that. That means she consented that, yeah, it was her. يعني this hadith, many of the ulama said it was ضعيف, many of the others said it is strong, يعني, but it is a hadith صحيح. So the Sheikh said the majority, يعني the outcome of that in madhahib in this touching, they are two sides and there is a middle. One, they said that wudu will break by touching, period, right? Those who are saying touching means skin over skin. Those who said it is intercourse, we know that tahara has to happen after that. It would break wudu, it would break everything. So that one, we are talking about those who say it is touching of the skin. So a group said that it will break the wudu, and wudu needs to be made. And those are the Shafi'is, with the differences in the intricacies of the mas'ala, as we talked about. The other side, al-ahnaf, they said it does not break the wudu, period. And in the middle, they said if it is done with a lust or not, this is the madhab of Malikiyah, said if there is a lust or you know emotions there, then a person had to have wudu. If not, then he does not have to have wudu. Type somebody would say, what is the opinion of Ahmed ibn Hanbal? يعني we talked about الشافعي on one side and أبو حنيفة on one side and some others in the middle, but we did not mention أحمد. الشيخ here is saying that all three opinions are in the madhab of أحمد. يعني all of this are narrations from أحمد. Sometimes الإمام أحمد you'll find six opinions in the same مسألة. Yeah. Why? Because Imam Ahmad Muhaddith and he spent a long life in giving fatwas. So sometimes it is the opinions happened all the different stages of life. طيب, inshallah, we'll stop here tonight. Next time, inshallah, what is left, يعني, just to give you a heads up, is al-istaaza. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, reciting it. What is the istaaza? What is the format of istaaza? Number one, reciting it, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Reciting الاستعاذة outside of صلاة and inside of صلاة before the recitation of Quran. What are the مذاهب? بسم الله, is it part of الفاتحة or not? It is part of الفاتحة but not part of other surahs. You recite it in the middle of the surah or not if you start. All of this we'll talk about inshallah in the last session. Next time it might be a little bit longer session. And then after that we will say, you know, where the استعاذة happens. And the takbir in the salah, not the takbir for the ruku' and sujood. There is takbir also between the surahs. يعني you say لا إله إلا الله والله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والضحى. You say that in the قراءة. يعني we'll talk about that inshallah. And what is the حكم of reciting with قراءات, different قراءات, the 7 قراءات, the 10 قراءات, the 14 قراءات, or any other that in the salah? What is the حكم of all of that? That's what is left يعني in our book here, and what would be considered لحن يعني mistake, you know, in the قراءة, that a person can be imam or not, and the building of the masajid or staying in the masajid for Muslims and non-Muslims, صوم and اعتكاف, you know, حج, you know, all of these things, بيوع and فرائض. We have nikah, talaq, khul' all of these things. Inshallah, we'll see next time. يعني we hope inshallah to finish this course next time. If not, inshallah, Allah Azza wa Jal will يعني help us. Inshallah, but most likely we'll finish inshallah next time. Jazakumullah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.